Live on Tape, Work in Progress, a World at Work podcast about work, life, and everything in between. With award-winning radio host Tom Alexander and Workspan's Not Safe for Work columnist Charles Epstein. Here are your hosts, Tom and Charles.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Work in Progress. I'm Tom Alexander, along with my partner and good friend, Charles Epstein. Hey, Charles.
Hey, Tom. How you doing?
Doing well, thanks. Getting ready here for show 22.
Oh, my goodness. 22. Don Clendenin's old number, by the
way. Yes, Don Clendenin's old number.
Yes, yes. Clink, in the spirit of the 1969 Mets. Oh, and by the way, not long after we spoke with Ron Swoboda several weeks back, he had, I think it was a double bypass?
Yeah, a triple, I believe.
It was a triple bypass.
Wow. A triple. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, I hope he's recovering. We've not heard. We should probably reach out. That was a real popular interview. We got so much terrific feedback on that.
Yeah. And I'll tell you, he was just a great guest, and we certainly wish him well in his recovery, and love to have him on again when he's up to it.
Oh, yeah, yeah, definitely. You know, last week we had a really interesting conversation on certification with Scott Kaywood and Amy Dufresne. And at one point, they were talking about people getting really stoked when they pass a course and get certified. You know, I get it. It's tough doing that kind of stuff, particularly as you get older, studying and test taking gets harder and harder, like having patience or having a steady stream. I'm not sure that's too much information, but there you go.
I hear that one. Unfortunately, I don't hear it all the time. That's also a problem.
That's also a problem. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I got to thinking that, you know, it's a good thing to challenge yourself every so often and take yourself out of your comfort zone. Have you done anything? Could you think of anything you've done in the past 2 years, 5 years, 20 years? We did something like that. You said, hey, I'm going to learn a new language. I'm going to learn a new instrument. I'm going to learn how to juggle a set of steak knives. Yeah, anything like that?
You know, I've thought about a lot of those things. Never really have done any of those. I mean, I've had to maybe expand on an existing skill in some capacity. I definitely have.
Right.
I can name a few of those, but not what you're saying exactly. Now, I do have, I guess, sort of a bucket list thing that I can, you know, and it's something I've always wanted to do and have still even thought about doing someday. You might know what it is, because you and I have talked about this a lot in just our own conversations.
Yes, yes. But I don't know how you're going to do it. Naked ice skating. It's a very interesting undertaking. I'm sure it's a very picturesque kind of sport. Yeah. But I wish you the best of luck. No. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah. You and I have spoken a few times, more than once, certainly, about our shared passion for diners.
Mm.
You know, the classic New York, New Jersey, Northeast quadrant of the country, those old diners.
Sure.
With my heritage being what it is, Greek American, you know, well.
No, you know, no, newsflash. I don't think we've addressed that on the podcast yet.
Yeah. Well, you know full well that almost all the classic diners in the Northeast are Greek run, Greek owned. For some odd reason, it's just something my ancestors tend to gravitate towards.
Cheeseburger, 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 cheeseburger. No fries, chips, and no Pepsi Coke.
I was hoping, Charles, that the ancient drives would not overtake me, but but they have. I really would love to have a diner one day, and you know, I've got a million recipes and some good ones. You know, I always thought that would be something I'd be very, very good at.
Well, I'm all for it because those are in short supply. And I tell you, those diners, yes, it's the closest thing you can get to a Bronto burger. When you go to those places, I mean, you know, they do not shortchange you on the portions. And there are just some classics, you know, any Greek diner, from Greek diner to Greek diner, can't miss.
Cheeseburger, 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 cheeseburger,
scam is, but no, I'm all for it. I'm all for it. So when you're ready to get serious, you want to lay out the business plan, you know, you want to make some investor presentations, let's get right to it, man. I'm totally down with that. So
well,
long.
Listen, there's a lot of money in Boca. You know, you must, you know, and you hobnob in some pretty lofty circles. You could probably raise the money for that, can't you?
Yeah, probably. And as you well know, Boca is the sixth of the five towns. You know, there is a real serious New York, Long Island contingent, and I think that kind of diner would really resonate. No, it's something we need to do, and as I said, I'm totally down. You know, as far as a comfort zone, you know, it's funny, actually doing this is out of my comfort zone. You'll recall years ago, you dragged me kicking and screaming into a studio, and I wasn't even expecting to participate. I was just there window dressing. I was there to observe. And all of a sudden, you have me mic'd up, and I'm sitting in the studio, and you tell the engineer to record. You shove some papers under my nose, and, you know, the first several takes, I was humming-a-humming-a, what am I doing? Then, you know, after a while, I'm getting settled in, and I'm really enjoying it. And, you know, about, you know, half an hour in, I'm basically ordering staff around and asking where my smoking jacket is. And all of a sudden, I've transformed it to Lawrence Harvey.
Yeah, absolutely. The humana, humana, humana is kind of, you know, they got reduced to humana, humana, and then humana, and then hmm.
Yeah.
And then it was perfectly fine.
Then it was perfectly fine. You know, it sounded like I was actually thinking in real time. So it was great.
Yeah. Yeah.
And no, but it's true. And I never expected to do that. And obviously, that was the beginning of really what we're doing now. And I am very much a work in progress. But back then, it was a completely alien thing. And you just threw me into the deep end. And thank you for doing that.
Hey, listen, you know, anything for a friend. I feel that you know, we might have something going here where if we open up the diner, you know, we can broadcast or podcast from the diner, right?
Ooh, I like it.
Right?
I like it.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Build a nice glass booth, and we'll you know, we'll have our the wait staff bring us some spanakopita and burgers, and we'll just do the show from there.
I really love that idea. Let's get it going. As soon as we're off, we'll huddle up. I'll bring in Jim Bendix to help us out with the business plan.
Here at the Bendix Corporation, we make your life better.
Ah, yes.
I'll bring, you know, and he could bring in some of the money people, and we're going to get this rocking and rolling, man.
I love it, man. And anytime the Bendix Corporation can be involved, you know, it's got legs.
Oh, it's got legs, it's got tentacles, and some of them are going to wind up wrapped around your throat, but that's okay.
I think you're right. Moving right along, we should tell our listeners who our guests are today.
Sure.
We have joining us the founder and CEO of Rework Work. It is Stacey Gordon. And Rework Work is a training and consulting organization centered on advancing women and professionals of color. And also, we're joined by Michael Zildjian, and he is an author, podcaster, stand-up philosopher, and the founder of Zilosophy, Michael Zildjian. And if any musicians are in the audience, you may recognize that last name, Zildjian, the famous maker of great cymbals for over 300 years. It's pretty incredible, almost 400 years, actually. And we'll even chat a little bit about that as well. That's coming up on Work in Progress. He's Charles Epstein. I'm Tom Alexander. We're back in just a moment.
Cheeseburger, 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 cheeseburger. No fries, chips, and no Pepsi Coke.
What to do when you need external HR expertise? Head on over to World at Work's vendor directory, kind of like the Yelp of HR, but without the biases. It's where to turn when you're looking for resources and providers in the world of HR. From legal services to compensation management, to loyalty programs, to exec comp, to relocation services, and so much more. You'll find pros in the vendor directory, a seemingly endless reserve of vetted, trusted HR providers. Visit worldatwork.org and take a look.
Stacey Gordon is an innovative human capital strategist whose mission is to reduce bias in global talent acquisition and management. Stacey is the founder and CEO of Rework Work, a training and consulting organization centered on advancing women and professionals of color, believing that a diversity strategy is simply a change management strategy. Stacey, welcome.
Thank you. I appreciate you inviting me on.
Well, it's great to have you. Please say hello to my partner, Charles Epstein.
Hello, Charles. How are you doing today?
Hey, Stacey. Great. You're calling in from Los Angeles, if I'm not mistaken?
I am, yes. I'm in Los Angeles. I was in Atlanta a couple days ago, but in Los Angeles today.
Okay. And Los Angeles is where you're based, right?
It is, yes.
Okay. Very nice. Yeah, we seem recently to have a bunch of people from the West Coast. So in any case,
it's nice out here.
It is. I know it's nice out there. And unfortunately, not quite as nice down here in South Florida where we're based. It tends to get a little bit intense this time of the year. And all I can say is, yes, thank God for air conditioning, cars with air conditioning, and all
bug
of that.
Spray.
And oh my goodness, yes, bug spray, also to keep the bugs away. But no, that's sort of an implicit joke about the people you tend to run into here in South Florida. But we digress. Anyway, in our previous shows, we discussed pay equity, sexual harassment in the workplace, credentialing. Not exactly hilarious topics, but we challenged each person we had on to share a funny story. Surprisingly, they each managed to make these topics somewhat funny. I don't think we had any LOL moments, but on balance and considering the level of difficulty, not too bad. So if you choose to accept this assignment, Stacey, and no pressure, but if you can think of a funny story on the not always hilarious topic of diversity in the workplace, we'd love to hear it. Not right now, but if during the course of our conversation, something occurs to you, you know, by all means, you know, say something, clear your throat, say, guys, I've got it, and the floor is yours, okay?
Gotcha, okay.
Okay. Anyway, you describe your work as being built on, quote, awareness, intentionality, and openness, end quote. What do you mean by intentionality?
Yeah, so intentionality, you know, at the end of the day, it's taking action, right? It's being intentional about what you do. And it's actually, this is kind of a funny story.
very nice.
I can't even remember exactly what it was, but I basically said, you know, we have to be more diverse and inclusive in the way that we work together and treat each other. And I posted that on LinkedIn. And somebody responded who's also from the LA area, and they said, oh, well, it's very difficult. It's kind of hard to not be diverse living in Los Angeles. And I thought, oh, here we go. This is exactly the kind of thing I'm talking about. You have to be intentional. You can't just trip over people because you happen to trip over people who are different than you. You somehow think you're diverse and inclusive. Like, that's not how it works. You know, diversity and inclusion is intentional. You actually have to have a conversation with people and intentionally invite people in to your network, into your conversation, into your project, into your life. And the fact that you happen to drive by them on the 405 does not count as intentionality. So
I guess it would be sort of drive-by diversity, literally. So what you're
right.
basically saying, so what you're saying is that diversity requires work. It doesn't just
it
happen.
It does, and it's not the hard kind of work, right? Like when we think of work, we think of drudgery. It really, I won't say it requires work. I just say it requires thought and it requires action.
Mm. Yeah. Stacey, I see that you have a course on unconscious bias. Perhaps you can share several examples of how this unconscious bias expresses itself in the workplace.
Yeah, I mean, there are so many ways that unconscious bias will express itself. And it's always the small things, right? So we talk about microaggressions, and it sounds like such a scary, awful word. And really, it's just those little things that happen within the workplace that when you add them up over time, become a problem. And it's akin to the fact that I was talking to a potential client a few weeks ago, and I said, you know, you don't have any major issues with your recruitment. I said, but the problem is, it's like a beaver trying to build a dam, right? If you put one twig in the middle of a river, it's not going to do much. But over time, you keep building twig after twig after twig after twig, and before you know it, the river stopped. And that's really the way that you know, unconscious bias works within the workplace, is you have the opportunity to bring in somebody new, and you say something as innocuous as, well, I don't know if they'll work, if they'll fit in this environment, or not quite sure that this is the space for them. Well, what do you mean by that? And we've all said it. But when you stop and you ask yourself what you mean by that, there's usually some kind of thing that's preventing you from being open and from inviting them in, because they're different than you. They don't think like you, or they don't look like you, or they don't come from the same geographic region, whatever it is. You know, there's more than 150 different types of bias. So it makes us all sound like jerks, right? Because it's like, oh my gosh, well, if we all have this bias, how are we supposed to do anything about it? But that's where it goes back to being intentional. It's understanding that, yeah, you know what? My initial reaction is to reject you because you're different than me. But I have to overcome that and say, well, that's silly. I don't have to do that. Let me actually give this person a chance. And yeah, that's the intentional piece that we have to do.
Yeah. 150 different kinds of bias. You said that's the number, 150. That's
At least.
That's amazing. That's just an astonishing number.
So is there a way of systematically disabusing people of this unconscious bias? I'm curious what the course contains, how you go about this.
Yeah, so for me, honestly, it goes down to a very simple thing, which is socialization. We just have to be around more people that are different than us. And if we do that, then we see people as not so different than us. But we never have the opportunity to do that because we keep people who are different from us at arm's length. So it is counterintuitive, and that's why, you know, people will say, well, it's work. Because you do have to get comfortable being uncomfortable. But what happens is, once you do it once or twice, it becomes second nature and you're no longer uncomfortable.
Yeah, you know, I wonder these days if people are more exposed to different people at the workplace more than they are when they go home. I'm assuming that that's very much the case.
It is, for sure. But the question is, and I always ask this question too in my trainings, is how many different people do you talk to every day? You might have 100 people on your floor, but how many of them do you actually interact with? How many of them do you have a conversation with, speak with every day? And when you look at that, if you were to track, you know, how many people you actually spoke to every day, it would probably be the same 5 people in a week.
Mm. That's, very true. You know, there were a lot of myths surrounding the issue of pay equity. Women aren't good negotiators. They don't gravitate to certain jobs or positions. What would you recommend that women, particularly women of color, need to cultivate? What skills or attitudes should they focus on and develop to gain equal footing in the workplace?
You're going to laugh when I say this, but this isn't the funny thing. I would say that they don't have to do anything. You know, as a Black woman, we are already showing up. We are already doing our best. We are already trying our hardest. We are doing really great work. The problem is, we're not being recognized for it. That's not something we have to fix. That's something management has to fix. That's something managers have to fix. That's something leadership has to fix. That's something that the CEO of the organization has to fix within their processes and their procedures. It's not anything that we have to do.
So there's nothing someone can do coming up or at the workplace, seeking out a mentor. It basically is from on high, things have to change in that way?
Yes. I mean, so that's systematic, right? That you always have to look at micro, macro. From a macro standpoint, all that has to change has nothing to do with the individual. Of course, on an individual level, one in two people. I mean, if you look at President Obama, that's a perfect example. Oprah, great example, right? People like to point to them and say, oh, well, look, they've done really well. Yes, they have on an individual basis. Because, of course, you're always going to have individuals that can rise above and can, you know, do things differently. So, yes, from an individual basis, as a woman, as an African-American woman, as a Latina woman, you can find a great sponsor or a mentor within your organization, and you can do well within your organization. But what we don't want is for people to point to that one person and say, oh, well, she's done a great job, so everyone else should be able to do the same as well. She's having to overcome so many different things and having to do so much extra. Why does she have to go and get a mentor and a sponsor and a this and a that and different training when others don't?
Right. Yeah, no, it's a good point. It's a good point. It's just that, you know, it's got to be frustrating if you are in this system that doesn't give you those opportunities. And it's almost counterintuitive or unnatural not to want to be, you know, to exercise some agency over that and do something to say, well, I have to wait for things to change. Seems to be a passive position and must be quite frustrating.
Oh, yeah. No, and for sure. And I'm not advocating passive at all. I'm just saying that for things to really change quickly, then it needs to change from the top down. The reason it's taking years, you know, and they're talking about, you know, be 20, well, I can't remember the numbers, 2055 or 21, whatever, before women get to equal parity, is because we're trying to do it individually, one by one by one. Doesn't mean we're stopping. We're still moving. We're trying. But if you actually want to move that number and move the needle faster, then the systems have to change.
Yeah, and it's interesting. You brought up, you know, Oprah and President Obama, you know, and people saying, hey, look, see, it's they did well. And of course, we also heard when Barack Obama won the presidency, well, you know, from a sector of people, unfortunately, a large sector of people, say, hey, racism's over now. You know, we remember that statement. And it's pretty incredible, you know, that there is thinking like that, that there isn't still a long way to go, right?
Well, for sure. I mean, I always tell people, it's not a popular statement, but if you find yourself uttering the words, racism is dead, you're probably a little bit racist.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like the I don't see color. It's like, really? You don't happen to see that a black woman standing in front of you right now? You don't?
Yeah.
Not at all.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, the classic Dave Chappelle bit comes to mind. If you recall,
which one is that?
He was the one that immediately comes to my mind is the one where he's blind and he's clearly black, but he doesn't know this, and it turns out he's very racist.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's what happens, though, is we're all systemically moved towards one set of rules. And that's what we're all taught and learn. And regardless of the color of your skin or your gender, you know, when what is seen in front of you is that the way to get ahead is, or at least the fastest way to get ahead, is if you are, you know, a Caucasian male, right, who's over 6 feet tall, because, of course, the taller you are, the more money you make, and the higher you rise, who has a monosyllabic name, right? You're a Dave, a Tom, or a Bob. Your odds of making it are a lot higher than somebody whose name is, you know, Jamisa, you know, Jones, right? Like, it's just on paper. When you look at studies that show that there's a study that I use in our upcoming course on inclusive recruiter, which is basically talking about unconscious bias, gender, and LGBTQ awareness. And in there, we talk about the fact that there's a study where a university is going to hire lab managers, and they took the resume of this person, and they made the name female, and on the other, they made the name male. Everyone who looked at the male name was like, oh, yeah, he's great. He'd be perfect, blah, blah, blah. They changed it to a woman, and they said, oh, you know, she was somehow less qualified, less intelligent, and less likely to actually receive mentoring from the other scientists that were in the university.
Mm.
Just from a name change.
Yeah, and it's interesting you say that, because I'm reminded of a television writer from the 1960s and 70s named Dorothy Fontana, who wrote a lot of television shows, Star Trek being one of them, and a lot of other dramas. And she went by DC Fontana because DC, you know, you don't know if it's a man or a woman. And that was the 1960s, of course. So you talk about a name change. Our guest is Stacey Gordon. She is the founder and CEO of Rework Work, a training and consulting organization centered on advancing women and professionals of color. Stacey, there have been a number of stories on how Amazon discovered that its internal recruiting tool was dismissing female candidates. This is because it was trained on historical hiring decisions, which favored men over women. So it learned to do the same. As more companies rely on AI to make hiring decisions, essentially becoming their gatekeeper, have you any thoughts on how to correct these biases?
Yes, so it's interesting. I actually did a talk in Bucharest, Romania. They flew me out for Tech Week to talk about unconscious bias and technology. And we discussed the idea that technology is still created by man, right? And so you really have to still focus on removing the bias before you can do the programming. And that there are certain places, you can't rely on it totally, but there are places where it definitely helps. And this isn't even a technology situation, but when you think about the fact like blind hiring is something that there are a lot of technology apps that will allow you and help you to do this now, right? Where you can anonymize your candidates. But what I tell people is that's great in certain instances, right? It's great when you're testing for skill, but it's not great when you're just testing or when you're, you know, doing a blanket hire, you know, because for example, I am a Black woman. I happen to enjoy being a Black woman and I don't want to be hired by somebody who doesn't know that a Black woman is going to walk in their door on the first day of the job, right? So those are not attributes that I want to hide. However, during the skills-based portion of the hiring, that is where you do want to maybe to get to the pool you can anonymize. Because if you say everyone has to have this skill and do this thing and know how to, you know, push this button, then you don't need to know if they're Black or white or male or female or gay or not, right? You just need to know, can they do this? And then you can take the anonymization off of that and then move forward from there, right? And you're still going to have bias. We are biased people. That's just how we operate. So bias isn't bad. It just is. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the other thing when we talk about bias. You know, everyone wants to say, oh, you're going to start wagging your fingers and telling me I'm a bad person. No, we all have bias. The bad person is the person who refuses to acknowledge that they have bias and do anything about it.
Right. Yes, of course. Of course. You know, WeWork has gotten a lot of attention lately as it prepares its IPO. It was revealed that its board is all male, which is very common, as I'm sure you know, among these kinds of companies, particularly technology companies. Although, as an aside, whether or not WeWork is really a technology company is open for debate. what do you recommend? Can anything be done to address this imbalance?
Oh, for sure. Things can be done. I mean, there's so many things that can be done to address the imbalance of women in leadership. You know, the first thing that always comes to mind is, especially if you talk about tech, they say, well, there aren't enough women in tech. How would you know, really? Right? Because if you look at, if you only have hired, let's say, 10% women, or, you know, you have 10% of women in leadership positions, but at least the pipeline has more than that. So until you have actually used up your pipeline, you can't say that there aren't enough, you know, fill in the blank, because most people aren't hiring to the capacity of the pipeline that's available. you're not going to get to 50%. I'm not even trying to get you to 50% to parity yet. It's like, could you at least exhaust your pipeline that you have?
I think, you know, some people are, when they talk about these companies and the boards, I mean, part of the problem is that the VCs who are funding them are also dominated by male. So that unconscious bias, or maybe it's a conscious bias, who knows, manifests itself in who's on these boards. So maybe you have to make those changes, or at least focus on the VC side of the equation to see some change. I don't know.
Right. It definitely requires, again, being intentional. You have to intentionally say, we want to change this. So we need to make sure that we are searching for more women to bring into the pool, so that when we do put someone on the board, that is a higher likelihood it might be a woman. Because until you can get to 2 or 3 women on that board, you're not going to even hear the woman's voice, because putting one woman on the board just screams tokenism and actually then prevents her from being heard. So she might as well not be in the room. So you have to get to at least 2 or 3 in order to have any kind of effect.
Stacey, one more question. What advice would you give to a young woman, particularly a young woman of color who's, say, in grade school or high school and starting to think of a career? What should they be doing to prepare themselves?
What should they be doing to prepare themselves? I would say, you know, keep up the grades and start looking for people that are in the roles that they are considering, so that they can start to ask, you know, how did you get here? What did you do? What resources would you suggest I look into? What types of internships should I be potentially looking for? You know, it's just like, what's that path? Because, you know, somewhere I read, and I can't remember where, I wish I could remember where I saw this, but there was a quote that said something along the lines of, my job is to be the snowplow, so that those behind me can walk more easily through the storm. And so it would be finding those snowplows, you know, finding those people who have forged ahead, so that you can learn from their wisdom and learn from their mistakes.
You know, let me ask you a question. I wasn't thinking about asking this, but it occurs to me as we're talking about this. You know, I have a daughter. She's 19. She's in college. And, you know, I see her, we all see, you don't have to have a kid that age to see how ubiquitous social media is and how people's, particularly people that age, they're so immersed in it. But maybe you do have to have a kid to see firsthand the effects it can have. These kids are on 24/7. They go out of their house. They may as well be followed by Klieg lights and a team of hairdressers and makeup people. And this may be anecdotal, but I know from my daughter's friends, her cohort, there's just a very high incidence of, you know, anxiety, eating disorders, and so on and so forth. And it seems, again, this is very much anecdotal, that this stuff lands disproportionately on young women, maybe even young women of color. I don't know, but I do see it among young women. Do you see that? Does that play in what you're talking about here? Or is that something to be concerned about? Tom's question, how do you prepare young women for these careers?
I mean, that's a pretty large question, I would say, with regard to, you know, our topic at hand. It's probably a little bit off topic, but okay. as a mother of 3 daughters, I will say that it is something that does need to be addressed. And, you know, I'm constantly showing my daughters how what's on the internet and what's on TV is very different than what's reality. I mean, even myself as an example, I have these courses on LinkedIn. My youngest daughter thinks I'm a celebrity. And my middle daughter keeps explaining to her, no, mom's not a celebrity. She's like, this is what a celebrity is. Mom's not a celebrity. And it's like, but she's on TV, but she's on the internet, and she's got a book. And I'm like, no, that's not how this works.
Yeah,
we're in
somewhere,
a different society now.
Yeah.
Finding that we are using the internet in very different ways than we did previously. It opens up worlds. And so I think that's what is important for them to understand is, you know what, harness it, use it for good, And sometimes the trolls will come out and the things that are happening are not that great, but you have to be able to brush that off. And so, it's really important to build thick skin.
Yeah, well, you know, part of the reason I say that is that I know self-image is so important, and you know, up until fairly recently, our culture obviously has had a pretty clear idea of what feminine beauty looks like, mm-hmm. and so on and so forth. I think over time that has changed, but I was just sort of wondering, because this self-image, kids, regardless of who you are, what you look like, it is a big thing. And, you know, self-image is such a big thing. And to the extent that self-image does have sort of a racial, or can have a racial aspect, in the sense that our culture endorses, you know, this look versus that look, it just occurred to me that maybe this is part of the conversation, or part of the whole thing that we're talking about here.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's a huge, we could have a whole like 3-hour discussion about that. I mean, there's so many things about it. But I'll just leave it and say that, you know, they've got to understand the difference between what's happening online and reality, and also have a thick skin, you know. And I've learned that, especially being in this business and the work that I do. And I'm very lucky, and I'm knocking on wood right now, because I don't get the kind of trolls that I would expect, unless LinkedIn is very good at hiding that stuff, which I think they are pretty good at doing some of that. You know, people can contact me through my website. They can contact me through LinkedIn. And I get a lot of people, I would say 98 out of 100, that love the work. And I'll maybe get 2 that say, you're an idiot. You don't know what you're talking about. You know, this is BS. You're a reverse racist.
Right.
Stacey, we really appreciate your time joining us on the program. It was just really illuminating and really interesting to speak with you. And thank you so much.
No, thank you. I, you know, enjoyed the conversation, and hope that people will check out some of my work online.
Where can they find it online?
So they can find the LinkedIn Learning through LinkedIn, through their learning platform. I have 4 courses on there, 1 on diversity recruiting, 1 on unconscious bias, 1 on writing a resume, and 1 on making a career change. And then through my website, I'm also posting next month our new inclusive recruiter series. So that's a new thing to watch for. And they can listen into our podcast, Inclusionomics, which is everywhere that podcasts can be found.
Wonderful. And your website is?
Reworkwork.com.
Reworkwork.com. Stacey Gordon is an innovative human capital strategist whose mission is to reduce bias in global talent acquisition and management. She is the founder and CEO of Rework Work, and she spoke to us today from Los Angeles. We'll be back right after these words.
This is Work in Progress.
Data, the mantra of business today. It's nothing new to World at Work. It's no small feat that they've been collecting data on salary issues for its salary budget survey for more than 45 years. Think about it, 45 years. With close to 7,000 responses, 2019 salary budget survey is packed with insights on base salaries, merit budgets, promotional increases, and variable pay plans. Curious to know how your company stacks up? HR execs in the know rely on World at Work's Salary Budget Survey. Shouldn't you too? Go to worldatwork.org/salarybudgetsurvey to learn more.
Michael Zildjian is an author, podcaster, stand-up philosopher, and founder of Zilosophy, a platform that uses books, podcasts, and group discussions to teach self-awareness and honest self-evaluation, with the goal of helping people make informed choices that allow them to bring their best to whatever they do. Michael, how are you?
I'm doing great. That's a great bio. Who wrote that?
We're trying to figure that out. It
makes me sound really prestigious. I like it.
Yeah, it just showed up on our doorstep one day. Pretty amazing. Please say hello to my partner and good friend Charles Epstein.
Hello to my partner and good friend Charles Epstein.
Hey, Michael, good talking with you. The last time we spoke, actually, the three of us, was several years ago. You were a partner in another venture called Kukazi, a branding and marketing firm out of Los Angeles. I have to tell you, Michael, I didn't see this coming. Stand-up philosopher, which either means you're Dave Chappelle on a toga or Plato, workshopping some new material at the improv. So I'm not sure. So what exactly is a stand-up philosopher? And second, what exactly is zilosophy?
Yeah, I think that somewhere between Dave Chappelle and Plato is a great thing to describe it, because I'm certainly not as funny as Dave Chappelle and not as wise as Plato, but I do like to use humor and philosophy to help myself and my friends and family, and now as a career, people I don't even know. To me, it's a nod to Mel Brooks, right? From History of the World, Part One, stand-up philosopher.
Sure.
You guys remember that scene?
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
Arthur is in the unemployment office. So there's that. But also, I had told you guys before we started the call, right? I had this moment when I was in the entertainment business. You and I were talking, you just mentioned that. We were doing branding and all kinds of fun stuff, forward-thinking business models for entertainment. But I wasn't really happy. And then the Boston Marathon bombing happened, which happened 6 miles from where I grew up. And they caught the guys who did it a quarter mile from where I grew up. And that experience really shook me and made me realize that, hey, we're doing this wrong. We need to treat each other better. And then the next thought was, well, you know, who am I to say that? And who's going to listen to me? But I thought that really the only thing that I could do and that I could control is that what I do and say is always in my control, and how I react to outside forces is always in my control, whether I react or not react. And so I thought, well, if I'm just working on being the best person I'm capable of being every day, then that's the goal. That's good enough. Now, how was I going to turn that into a business? I had no idea. So I came up with this brand, Zilosophy, and I knew I had to write a book because, again, I was an entertainment guy. Nobody's going to listen to me spitting philosophy. My friends and family used to, you know, wax poetic with me all night long about that stuff. And I was always good about helping people get perspective on challenges that they face. And, you know, as you guys know, we all face challenges, and those never end. It's just a constant stream of what's the new challenge and what am I going to learn from it? How am I going to use this challenge to make myself better? And apologize if you're hearing construction vehicles pass by outside, by the way. Like I said, we can't always control what's going on outside, but I always have the control too. So I can focus on that, what's happening outside, or I can continue to focus on this call. And so I figured out that golf is a great way to tell that story, because it's just you, a stick, and a ball. And you have the opportunity to get that ball into a hole way down there, but there's a lot of stuff that happens in your head, and there's a lot of stuff that happens in the world around you that can prevent you from reaching your goal. So I thought that really self-awareness, honest self-evaluation, and then making good choices was really the story that I wanted to tell. And it just so happened that it's also the best way to play golf. I love golf. And I can sit there and blame everybody else or blame all the thoughts in my head, or I can zone in and focus on the brief moment of impact when I make a swing and I hit the ball and then see where it goes, and then go find it and hit it again. And to me, that's a great mirror of life. Things happen out there that we don't want to happen in life. We shank it in the woods, and then we got to go find it and hack it out and own it. And so that's a long answer about what a stand-up philosopher is. I don't really know. I can tell you that I don't study motivational speakers. I do a lot of speaking at schools for kids and corporations and sports teams. I study stand-up comics, because they're the best at telling the story and holding the crowd. And so to me, it was like, I wanted it to be light and fun. I wanted to say some pretty important messages,
But I didn't want to do it from a standpoint of I know everything and I've got it all figured out. I'm still working on all this stuff too. Mm. And I think that's the conversation we all need to have. There's stuff we all need to work on, and we can support each other in working on it and being our best, or we can keep pointing fingers at each other and throwing rocks at each other. And I just didn't want to do the latter of that.
Michael, I'm sure many of our listeners have heard the name Zildjian. If you're a musician, especially, it's one of the premier names in the business. I've been a musician almost all of my life, and I can tell you, whenever I see those letters on those symbols, Zildjian, I know exactly what that is, and the sound and all the history that comes with it. It was founded in Constantinople by Avitus Zildjian in the 17th century, making it one of the oldest companies in the world, now based in Massachusetts. Do you have any involvement in the company?
I don't. They are the people that run it are my cousins, and I'm pretty close with them. We stay in, you know, somewhat contact a few times a year. When I was in the music business, I would see them at trade shows a lot more. But now that I'm actually living back in Massachusetts, I go by the factory every once in a while. And, you know, people are always, you know, asking me to help them get connected to the company. So I'm always passing leads to them. But I don't work in the company. I've never worked in the company. And at the same time, I'm very proud of my heritage. Yeah, I mean, it's the oldest continuously family-run business in the United States. And that's a pretty big thing, right? If you think about that, of all the companies that have existed in this country.
Yeah.
Started in 1623, the guy Avitus was an alchemist, and he came up with this great alloy, and he went to show the Sultan, like, hey, check this out. And basically the Sultan said, great, you work for me now, and your name is Zildjian. And Zildjian literally translates to son of a symbol smith in Turkish and Armenian, sort of combined. Mm-hmm. So that's what, you know, as any king, any person that worked for a king, you were called by the job that you did. The interesting part of that story is, I don't know how, but somehow 5 years later, he was able to get pardoned and start his own company. And to get pardoned by a king in the 17th century is probably is a pretty big feat. He must have known or seen something, I would guess.
he had drawings, right? I guess they don't. I have pictures. No, that was I have drawings. I have sketches.
Turkish court paparazzi.
So the background then is Armenian, but he lived and worked in what was then, I guess, part of the Ottoman Empire, Turkey, right?
Correct. Yeah. So the IAN at the end of a name, an Armenian name, means son or daughter of.
Yes.
Zil in Turkish means symbol, and the DJ sound is a sound that means craftsman. So it literally translates to son of a symbol maker or symbol maker. And, you know, the family name was different before that, right? That's a made-up name. That's what most people don't know, because that's what that guy's job turned out to be, and that's what the family name was changed to then and has remained ever since.
Have you ever been able to determine or find out what the original family name was?
I was told, and I generally don't do any research, right, even about my own family, but I've been told it was Kazanjian, which is a fairly common Armenian name, not like a Smith, but more like a Jones type of a name from back then.
right. That's really interesting. And yes, IAN is, you know, quite prevalent with Armenian names. I play with two musicians who are, their roots are Armenia, and both of them, IAN at the end. So, and that means son or daughter of, right?
Right.
Yeah, that's great.
It's just like, you know, whatever, I don't know, Samuelson, right?
Yeah.
That name, where does that name originate from? There's a guy named Samuel, and then he wanted his family to call him Samuelson, right? So it's the same kind of thing.
Well, I could tell you that my original name, Alexopoulos, almost all Greek names end in OS or IS or something like that. So I know where you're coming from.
Yeah. Well, Tikanis, my Greek brother.
Yes. Thank you. Gala. Before we get into your book, Michael, your podcast and the talks you give to schools and businesses. Several years ago, you started Zilosophy Consulting. Now, I know you also have a broad marketing background, and I know you're providing strategic consulting to a broad range of corporate clients. How does Zilosophy inform your corporate consulting work?
Yeah, well, mostly I'm not doing as much consulting as I was. I'm really focusing on the speaking and writing aspect of the business at this point. That was really mostly a bridge to get to this point, because I didn't know, and we'll, like you said, we'll get into it, but like, I had never written a book before. I had never been a speaker before. I'm by nature a pretty shy guy. I didn't know if I could do any of that, pull that off. So what I knew I could do was use this sort of new awareness that I was working on about being my best to help companies, right? Because when I go and talk to corporations now, you know, what I talk to them about is like, how does everybody do their own part? How do we each take our own responsibility to do our part, to work together as a unit, to be the best company we're capable of being? Well, you can't worry about what Karen's doing at the copy machine or Johnny's doing at the coffee machine. You have to worry about your lane and your specific activities and goals that helps move the company forward. And if everybody, again, takes their own accountability to be their best employee they're capable of being every day, then by nature, the company runs better. And that does go straight to the bottom line. And that, a lot of that does go back to the Kukazi days with Kelly and I. We used to consult people like Yamaha Motors. We had this big project that actually never went anywhere, but we pitched them on this huge deal of, hey, you know, if you take on being the most active proponent of motorcycle safety, and you really do it and mean it, your customers will know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you actually give a shit about them and that you are in business not just for yourself, but also for your customers. And when you do that and when you prove it, they buy more stuff, right? And it's just a better way to live and a better way to do business. It's sort of a holistic approach that, hey, you know, we're all stuck here on this planet together, whether we like it or not. But we're in it together by definition, so maybe we should act like it. And at a company, of course, same thing. We're in this together. We should be working together. And everybody, if everybody does their best, then the company is better for it and does make more money because people are happier. They do their jobs better. They come up with better programs that have philanthropic, you know, meaning behind it. And so, yeah, I mean, that's the type of consulting that I do when I'm still asked to do it, which is a little more rare these days because, again, like I said, I'm really focused on writing and podcasting and speaking and getting these messages out there whenever I can.
Yeah, it's interesting you say that because, I'm remembering that you and Kelly Kukazi, that was so fundamental to what you did for these companies, sort of trying to find something beyond what they did, sort of go to a cause that they could get behind. And I think you talk about that, how that may promote a certain esprit de corps internally. But I think a lot of people these days, particularly millennials, you see this in study after study, they gravitate to companies that are known for being good corporate citizens. So it's right. Important on both sides of the equation. And I'm about to make a pretty corny little joke, but I guess Zilosophy Consulting was a Hogan's Bridge to Zilosophy. On golf. You didn't expect to get a master's related joke in this conversation, no. I'm sure.
I love master's related jokes. I don't know if anybody else got it, but I did. So
okay, nailed it. Good. But you know, anyway, speaking of, so your book, The Zilosophy on Golf. Frankly, you know, this is what I've been eager to talk to you about since we scheduled this up. First, because I have my own Zilosophy on golf, which could be summed up as don't. No good will come of it. You'll never experience anything as frustrating as hitting a small stationary ball into a small hole. You know, when I got down here from New York some years ago, I decided to sink a good amount of money into a set of clubs, thinking that I'd be less likely to heave them into the water hazard after yet another double bogey.
Right.
You know, which was, I thought, it worked. I still have the clubs. Yes, I still have the clubs. Anyway, here's a description of your book. Golf, like many seemingly trivial activities, can be a great mirror of life if we are willing to see our own reflection. If you tend to overthink, are often filled with anxiety or run short on patience, if you are hard on yourself or suffer from a lack of joy in your golf game, then it is likely that those same things are adversely affecting your life off the course as well. Again, that's from your introduction. I don't disagree, but from my personal experience, the only lesson I've ever taken away from a round of golf, other than to use big muscles and to keep your head down, is that it's a very, very tough game. And as I said before we hit the record button, the one thing I do know about golf is that you will be humiliated. The only question is to what degree.
Yeah, it's an incredibly difficult game. And that's why I love using it as a mirror for life, because so is life. Everything that you just described in that introduction, short on patience, hard on yourself, I wasn't listening, so I don't know what else you said. No, I'm kidding. But like that's a description of every person. We all struggle with these things. And as I told you before we went on air, we all have challenges, right? It's just the question, to what degree is that challenge? Sometimes they're brutal. I just happened to have gone through one of those in my personal life. I had a little cousin that succumbed to cancer and, you know, held his hand as he passed. And that was a pretty brutal time, and one that still hurts. But there's a lot that I learned from that too. And when we have things that go wrong in our lives, those are the moments that teach us. They help us grow. They help us become better. We don't like them, but they keep happening. And that's what you're saying about golf. We don't like that it doesn't go the way we want it to all the time. And it doesn't. And it never does. The best golfers in the world miss shots all the time. Granted, their misses are a little better than ours, but they miss. And that's what life is. We all miss. We do our best, or we don't, or we try our best. And even if we're trying our best, things go wrong. And then we have to own it so that we can move on. And, you know, as I mentioned in the book, Jason Gore wrote the foreword. He's a former PGA golfer, just took a job with the USGA as their player liaison. One of the best pieces of advice that I got about playing golf is that golf's a really simple game if you look at it like this. Hit the ball, find it, hit it again. That's the game. But we're human beings, so we overcomplicate it, and we make it about so many more things. But really, that's all it is. And so to me, it was like, okay, if you simplify golf, you can play better. But actually, if you practice those things like patience, dealing with anxiety, which we all have, dealing with frustrations, dealing with things going wrong in our view, if you work on those things, if you practice those things, they make you a better golfer. They also make you a better person. One of the best compliments I ever got on this new work was when a guy told me at a golf clinic, "I love your book. It's made me a better golfer. More importantly, it's made me a better dad."
Oh, and wow.
That's the point for me, is like, we can use a silly game like golf to become better people. And the byproduct of that can be playing much better golf, which is really fun. As you describe the torture, it stinks when you're playing bad, but it's really fun when you get it and you play well. And then, of course, you lose it, because life and golf have this funny way of teaching you. Every time you think you have something figured out, it likes to smack you down and tell you, nope, you actually don't know anything. Why don't you start over again?
Well, you know, one thing about golf that, well, tell me if I'm wrong. This is my experience, although speaking to other golfers, they say yes, I agree. You always know why you hit a shot wrong. Seldom do you know exactly why you hit a shot right.
Well, that's a level of awareness, right? Yeah, I don't think that most people actually do know why they hit it wrong. And I think that that's why most people play bad golf. I tell a story in one of the chapters in my book about how I played terrible golf for 19 years, but I played a lot. So I slapped it around and I got it in the hole and I made some scores, not great ones. Then when I actually had a friend go, look, he's an incredible golfer. And he's like, look, I can't watch you swing like this anymore. I got to teach you how to a proper swing. And then so that started a 2 to 3 year period of starting over and rebuilding my swing. And the lesson there is that we can work on something constantly and practice the wrong way and not get any better. Or we can work on things in a better way, in the right way, and practice things that actually allow us to be our best, whether that's playing golf or being a good father or being a good citizen or being a good employee, we have the opportunity to practice things every day that allow us to be our best. And as I said before, my hypothesis is that if everybody in the world took on the challenge of, I'm just going to be my best today, the best I'm capable of being today, given what's going on in my life, if we all did that and we all meant it, all the problems in the world would go away. We need over 7 billion people to take that on at the same time. So I can't control that. But what I can do is control myself and continue to talk about it so that hopefully more people take that on in their lives. And hopefully it makes things a little bit better.
Yeah, but just one last thing on that. It's interesting you say that a friend of yours took you aside and helped you rebuild your swing. Otherwise, you would have continued to groove a bad swing. Occasionally, yep. I'll see several people hit against a, you know, a tennis court, hit against a ball machine, and they're out there every day. They put in their time, but all they're doing is grooving bad technique.
Correct.
So they're getting more consistent at being bad.
Right.
So you do need that objective person to come in to give you some course correction. That's so important in sports and elsewhere.
And by the way, we all do that as people too, right? We get in these patterns that don't allow us to be our best worker we're capable of being. They don't allow us to be the best person in a relationship we're capable of being, best friend we're capable of being, the best family member, whatever. And we get in these bad patterns and we groove bad swings metaphorically in life. And that's what I'm trying to do is like, hey, let's look at this and let's all try and do a little bit better. Again, I can't control what anybody else is doing. I can just lead by example and do my best and be honest about the fact that all of the stuff that's in my book, all the stuff that are in my podcasts and my talks, are all things that I still work on. I'll never be perfect at patience. I'm not even really that good at it yet, but I work on it a lot. And when I lose my patience, I become more aware of it. And I realize that losing my patience doesn't allow me to play better golf, and it doesn't allow me to be a better person. So the practice is finding ways to be more patient. And that starts with awareness and acknowledging when I lose my patience. Then it comes to the honest self-evaluation of, hey, maybe there was a better choice there that I missed. And, you know, what are the things that I say and do? How do they affect how I get closer to my goals of good relationships or getting a ball into a hole? And then that's where you're allowed to, you make, create the space to make better choices. You know, I was playing golf a couple months ago, and I literally within 5 minutes almost got hit in the head twice from two tee boxes on the on the second hole and the 18th hole as I was coming up one. And I had my ball in the middle of the fairway, perfect pitching wedge distance away. Now, I could have been pulled into, oh my God, maybe I shouldn't be here. Maybe that's a sign. I'm nervous. Am I going to get hit again? Or I had the opportunity to practice being present in the moment that I was in. The moments where I almost got hit in the head had already happened. They weren't happening anymore. What was happening now was I had a ball at my feet, a perfect pitching wedge distance away, and I had the opportunity to focus on trying to make the best swing that I was capable of at that moment. I just so happened to have, in that case, pulled it off and hit it to 6 feet and made the birdie putt. But that doesn't always happen. But we can always try, right? That's the point. Are we trying to be our best at whatever we're doing? Are we bringing the best that we're capable of to whatever we're doing? That's what Zilosophy is really about.
Hmm. It's interesting you say that because I can tell you as a musician, very much the same philosophy, you know, kind of unlearn, undo bad habits, bad process, and tear it down and start over. And I do that every day. I always like to say for myself, my only goal is to be a little bit better than I was yesterday.
Right.
And that's kind of really where I am as a as a constant student in music.
That's right. And it never ends because there's always something to learn.
Yeah, absolutely.
You'll never be a perfect musician and you'll never be a perfect person, but you can always learn. You know better than most people, but I think a lot of people understand music even if they don't play it. And you understand that music is best played when you're not thinking, when you're just letting the music flow through you because you've put in the work and the practice to allow your limbs to do what you want them to do, and then you just feel it and let it flow. And that's really, I think, again, a good mirror for life. We overthink things a lot. And that's, we don't play our best when we do that.
No, there's no doubt. And I've had many people come up to me after during a break or something and said, how did you do? What was that that you just did? And I said, do what? I have no idea what you're talking about.
I wasn't there. I don't know.
Anyway.
But that's the practice, right? That's the practice of getting out of our own way.
Yeah.
I think something just happened through us and with us instead of trying to force it to happening. You know, you could practice drums for 20 years and become a pretty good technical drummer, but that doesn't mean you have any feel or know when to shut up, which is really the biggest problem for many drummers, to know when to leave space for the other instruments to be heard, right?
Very, very true. I'm sort of blessed to have a really musical drummer as a longtime partner in our band, and he's one of those exceptions to the rule, I think. Michael Zildjian is an author, podcaster, stand-up philosopher, golfer, and helps people bring their best to whatever they do. And Michael, in your book, in the introduction, you write, and I quote, years ago, I had a successful career in the music business, a great bachelor pad in the Hollywood Hills, and I traveled a lot while hobnobbing with rock stars and celebrities. It was a lot of fun, but something was missing, something big. I spent a lot of time building egos and bank accounts, but I needed to find a way to do something else. I wasn't sure what to do, but I knew that I needed to spend more time helping others. I'd always been good at guiding my family and friends through the challenges they faced, but how the heck was I going to turn that into a career? Go back to school, become a therapist? No thanks. That didn't feel right for me, close quote. Hobnobbing with rock stars and celebrities. Same. I hear you. Once you've partied on Kanye's Gulfstream and spent a weekend diving off the deck at Jay-Z's yacht, it starts getting old. but on a serious note, you're writing about a career crossroads. What you've been doing left you somewhat unfulfilled. Many at various points in their career find themselves stuck or restless. They may have an idea of what they'd like to try, but it's not easy. There's always risk involved. What would you say to the person who finds themselves at a similar crossroads?
Yeah, well, I would say don't do what I did unless you have a really strong heart and will. Because there were many days where I thought, am I just crazy? Could I actually be a writer and a speaker? I didn't know because I had never done it. But I knew that that's what I wanted to do. I would say that like the most important thing is that people end up just doing jobs, right? And then they know they're not fulfilled and they don't have the courage to start over. Now, I'm joking, but it's been a very serious transition in my life. And it took the better part of 5 years to get to the point where I figured out now only recently in the last year, oh my God, it actually worked. I actually am a successful author and speaker, and it's working. People actually like what I'm talking about. I've had kids at high schools tell me that I changed their life just by saying something to them. And to me, that's the most fulfilling part. So that's what I mean is like, find something that actually, we all got to do jobs, right? We got to live in this world because we're in it. But you know, finding something that actually calls to you is not something most people do. We just get stuck in these patterns. And again, a lot of people don't have the flexibility that I have. I'm not, you know, I was divorced when I was young. I don't have kids. I don't have a big house or mortgage payment or anything like that. So I was able to just drop everything and go, okay, I'm going to start over from zero. I'm going to recreate myself into something that I actually think might be fulfilling for me and that's something that might matter to me. Again, I think a lot of people are feeling that, like, they're seeing the stuff go on in the world and they're like, how do I help? How do I make a difference? You know, a lot of people are still caught in the pointing fingers thing and they watch either Fox News or MSNBC and we get pitted against each other and they're caught up in that. But I think a lot more people are starting to wake up and go, wait a minute, this isn't the way forward. You know, yelling at each other and saying those guys are the problem isn't making things better. And I think a lot of people are yearning for how can I do something that actually makes a difference? And to me, that's by looking inward and looking at yourself. What are the gifts that I have in life? You know, as I told you, I forget if we were on air or off air, but by nature, I'm a very shy person. I don't like standing in front of a crowd. It makes me really uncomfortable. But I'm actually pretty good at it. And I say things that help people. So I've worked very hard on becoming more confident, speaking more clearly, all of that stuff, because I actually have a gift for it. And I can use that gift to help people, and I can get paid really well doing it. Now, I happen to be very lucky that that worked out for me. But what I would say to someone that's feeling that is that life is hard no matter what we do, no matter what we choose. So why not choose? It's going to be hard anyway. Why not choose something that actually feels like you, that you know that this is you? When I started doing this work, and when it finally came together, like I said, in the last year, I feel more like myself than I've ever felt, because this is me. This was the thing that I was hiding from the world because I was scared that I didn't know if it would work, and I didn't know if anybody would give a shit about what I had to say. And that's really confronting and scary. And so the practice was just having patience and faith. That's what I told myself every day. Faith that it'll work out the way it's supposed to, whether I become a writer or speaker or not. And the patience that, you know, things just don't happen overnight. And I have to practice the things that make me, allow me to be my best one day at a time, one moment at a time. And if I string enough of those moments together, maybe this will work. And like I said, I've been very fortunate. It has.
I got to tell you, you know, I'm just very impressed, Michael, that while this is a bit of a departure from what you've done, you know, for your career to date, which is mainly focused on marketing. But by the same token, it's very consistent with your values. You've carried those forward. So that's very, and it's also very impressive that you challenge yourself to do something that you are not naturally inclined to do, get up in front of people or put pen to paper and organize your thoughts in that way. So, again, very impressive. So anyway, what can we expect next from Michael Zildjian? Any other Zilosophy books? And if you take requests, I'd love to see what you come up with for tennis.
Yeah, well, I've been told several times, and one of the good and bad things about being an author is just about every day someone tells me a book I should read, as if I do nothing but sit around and read books.
or a book you should write.
A book I should write. But there is a book, something about the Zen of Tennis or something. I can't, spacing on the name. There is a book. But yes, what's next for me is that this book was meant to be the first in a series. The next book, I've sort of started. I keep getting caught. I think it's going to be yoga, because I've been practicing yoga for 22 years now. And, you know, there's not really a better teacher of self-awareness, honest but empathetic self-evaluation, and then commitment to making good choices. You know, the analogy in yoga is that we all have different bodies, so we don't stretch and move in the same way. We have to do our best with what in our body is capable of. And, you know, it's all the same practices that we're talking about with golf. So there's a book in my mind about yoga. There's one about poker. Tennis, I never really got serious about, but there's definitely a book there for sure. Maybe we'll even co-write one. I don't know.
I have some thoughts on that. So definitely. By the way, Zilosophy on yoga, that seems kind of on the nose. It's almost like a book, Zen on Zen.
Right. It's almost too easy. I think that's one of the reasons why I keep getting hesitating on starting it. It's basically only written in my head. I just have to sit down and do it, because it like you just said, it writes itself. So I'm really building up the speaking career this fall. I'm doing a lot of schools, doing some corporations, some sports teams. You know, next year in 2020, really want to build up the speaking business. And as I do that, I'll continue to write more books. It's all the same messages. I just want to be, again, to me, the best person I'm capable of being is being a positive role model in the world, where, you know, the ultimate goal of all of this, guys, is kindness. That's how this whole thing started. You know, I told you about the Boston Marathon bombing. I have a friend from Pepperdine, who is our class president, whose daughter was at a bar last fall, went to Pepperdine as well, and shooter walked in, shot and killed her, gone. 18 years old, freshman in college. And he and his wife obviously are still incredibly crushed by that. They'll never get over it completely, right? But their immediate reaction was, and this is what I'm talking about, self-awareness, honest self-evaluation, and making good choices. They had a choice to make how they were going to react to that. They could be miserable for the rest of their lives. They could be in despair. They could be angry. They could be hateful. Those are all choices that no one would blame them for making. But instead, what they chose was kindness. And I wear a wristband that says kindness matters, Elena's voice in her honor, which is a reminder to me that no matter what happens out there in life, we always have the opportunity to make the choice of kindness. And we always have the opportunity to spread kindness in this world. And if, again, if more and more of us take that on, then the world will get better and will be less crazy and we'll stop shooting each other in the streets. There's obviously all kinds of other factors that we could get into, right? You know, to me, the biggest one there is mental health. We've got a major mental health issue in this world and in this country, and that's what really needs to be addressed. And again, the ultimate goal of that is people healing their minds and emotions so that we can just treat each other kindly. It's a very simple thing, but it's simple to say, but not simple to do.
No, no, I have to tell you, man, you know, love the message. I love the passion. And you're doing great work, Michael. I'm very impressed.
Thank you. Thank you. It means a lot to hear that. Those are the moments that that remind me to keep going because it's working, right? So I need to hear that feedback, and I appreciate it.
Well, keep going for sure. It is wonderful. And we do appreciate your time today, Michael. Thanks so much for coming on Work in Progress.
Yeah, thanks for having me on. We are all works in progress. And again, my message is, let's just all work on the stuff that we each have to work on and not worry about what everybody else is working on. If we all do our best, things will be fine.
Absolutely. Michael Zildjian joined us today. He's an author, podcaster, stand-up philosopher, and founder of Zilosophy, a platform that uses books, podcasts, and group discussions to teach self-awareness and honest self-evaluation with the goal of helping people make informed choices, allowing them to bring their best to whatever they do. And he spoke to us today from Massachusetts. We'll be back in a moment.
What to do when you need external HR expertise? Head on over to World at Work's vendor directory, kind of like the Yelp of HR, but without the biases. It's where to turn when you're looking for resources and providers in the world of HR. From legal services to compensation management, to loyalty programs, to exec comp, to relocation services, and so much more. You'll find pros in the vendor directory, a seemingly endless reserve of vetted, trusted HR providers. Visit worldatwork.org and take a look.
Wrapping things up now on Work in Progress, along with Charles Epstein, I'm Tom Alexander, and two very interesting guests today, Charles.
Indeed. Stacey Gordon had some very, very interesting pointed things to say about diversity, and, you know, really makes you think about, you know, unconscious bias, this whole idea about intentionality and so forth. You know, it's a very fraught, difficult subject, but she has a real good handle and a real clear-eyed perspective on the whole thing. I thought that was really an interesting conversation. And of course, Mr. Michael Zildjian, he of Zilosophy. I did want to ask him a couple quick questions on Bertrand Russell, his thoughts on logical positivism, and the philosophical implications of the multiverse, but I didn't think we had the time.
Yeah, a little long for the podcast, Charles.
Probably would have taken us in several directions and blind alleys, and I don't think we wanted to go there. But it's cool that he's carved this out. I think he does have a terrific message. He's a really, really engaging guy. He's obviously led a very interesting life, very reminiscent of Mr. Bascinelli, who we met. Yes. In Orlando, guy who's had a very, very interesting life, had an epiphany of sorts, and has decided to share it and to make presentations and to engage with people where he finds them. You know, I got to applaud
their initiative and their ability to brand themselves and get out there with some very interesting messages. But I tell you, Michael is going to do he's going to have to try a little bit harder to convince me, you know, that sort of a quasi-Zen approach or a Zen way of thinking and golf go hand in glove, because, to me, golf, while it seems like it's a very controlled sport, just underneath the surface is a lot of intense aggression and frustration and borderline rage if you're having a bad round. So it's very, very tough to keep that all together.
Borderline rage? You should see me out of the course. It's like nothing borderline about that, buddy.
No. Yeah, when you're out there with there's a lot of preemptive ducking.
Oh, yes, absolutely. It's not a pretty scene.
No, you don't play golf. It's more like an assault on the course.
Yeah, that's exactly what that is. I think I have several bags of clubs at the bottom of ponds across the country, you know?
You know, years ago, when I was a kid, I actually did play a lot of golf. Since I've been down here, I play very, very little, mostly tennis. I'd like to get back into it a little bit later in my life when I'm able to cultivate some patience and I could spend 4 hours on a golf course without freaking out and needing to get back for some odd reason. But in any case, what I used to do is my backyard. I'd have, you know, these golf wiffle balls, and I'd take out a wedge or I'd take out a 7-iron and I'd hit balls against the house. And then what I'd do after, you know, I'd hit for about 45 minutes, an hour, I take a couple of actual golf balls. I turn around, and we had a high hedge. I really couldn't see over the hedge. But of course, it was, you know, a typical suburban little enclave. And I just blindly, you know, take my 7-iron and I just whack the ball and wait, hope that I didn't hear the tinkle of shattered glass. But what happened one day, I went to the bus stop and I get on the bus. And my friend Orna Tversky hands me a golf ball. And she says, Charles, I think this is yours. How did she know that? So that's a mystery that's nagged at me for quite a number of years now. One of these days, I'll get to the bottom of that.
Well, I have a somewhat similar story. As you know, my dad and his brothers were in the movie theater business, and we had a drive-in movie theater for a short time. And behind the screen, unbeknownst to me, was a mobile home park. Now, I didn't know this, of course, and in the afternoon, sometimes I would go on the speaker ramps and just tee them up and try to hit them over the screen, you know, just for fun. You know, I'd take a bunch of range balls and just drive them. So one day I'm just teeing off and I'm there with my friend and we're taking turns hitting the golf balls over the screen. And sure enough, about five minutes later, two guys start walking up toward us and I'm standing there with the club in my hand and they say, do you have any idea who's hitting golf balls over the screen and into our trailer park? You're almost knocking windows out. And with the club in my hand, I say, you know, I don't know, but if I find someone, I'll let them know.
Yeah, well, if they saw your swing, they'd probably know that, your slice is a little too extreme for it to have been you.
Yes, right. Now, went into the community swimming pool.
Yeah, if they came out with a golf ball there, then, yeah, they got you dead.
Yeah, right. Somebody in scuba gear was fishing them out. But right. On that note, I guess we should say goodbye until next time. Our guests again, Stacey Gordon, the founder and CEO of Rework Work, and Michael Zildjian, he, of course, an author, podcaster, stand-up philosopher, and the founder of Zilosophy. For Charles Epstein, I'm Tom Alexander. Thanks for listening to Work in Progress. We'll see you next week. So long, everybody.
This has been Work in Progress, a World at Work podcast about work, life, and everything in between, with award-winning radio host Tom Alexander and Workspan's Not Safe for Work columnist Charles Epstein. For more, visit worldatwork.org/workinprogress. That's worldatwork.org/workinprogress. Join us next week for another edition of Work in Progress.